going to start with praise and worship. So you can stand, you can clap, you can sing along, you can know the songs. Feel free to join us.
Let's do it.
Ready for this day, we're gathered in your name.
Upon only you, the heavens declare.
call on your name. Will you meet us here? We have come to this place to worship you, God of mercy and grace. It is you we adore. It is you, praises of all. Only you the heavens declare. It is you, only you. Holy, holy is your God Almighty. fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. 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 place your glory dwells. One thing I ask and I would see, to see your beauty to find you in the place.
Sheet started last week. We didn't get very far. Send out a survey, a few responses. So we'll bring that upstairs. Sign up. We may go around. I don't know. Sign people up for you. We'll see what we does. We're working on that, and that'll be good. So I'm looking forward to that. Then the discipleship group is here from Penya, the discipleship house. They come in
you'll get more information. They come in, they spend a time at the discipleship house, and they learn about discipleship. Am I right? Yes, yeah, right. I'm never wrong. So they're going to be here ministering to us today. And we also have Jesse and his wife, Kieran, here today. And Jesse's going to give us a little talk, and then we're going to have ministry from the discipleship group. So let's welcome them all here today. Thank you for coming. Next Saturday, breakfast, church breakfast, 8:30 here. Yeah, I know you were, Steve, but
I was going to do it.
I'm like, Steve's going to remind me. I better say it before he reminds me.
Yeah.
So, you know, and there's a revival night in Wellspring Church, January 22nd, 23rd. Check the website for more information about that. So, Jesse, come on up, or come on down.
Thanks, Wendy.
You're welcome.
Good to be here. We finally get to be here for hot dogs.
Amen.
We've heard about hot dogs every day before. I think every time we've been here, now we're finally we made it. So this will be fun. Quick introduction. Yes, my name is Jesse. My wife Kieran. We've been married for a little bit over a year now, and we're youth pastors at Wellspring in Kenyan. And the group that we brought with us is part of what we call a discipleship group. And I mean, basically, it's very simple. We simply believe that Jesus is still making disciples today, to those who want to be a disciple, to those who say yes to being a disciple. And he will lead you through discipleship, just as he led his 12 disciples through discipleship, if you let him. And so that's what these folks are here for, to just learn and to dig into deeper what it looks like to be a disciple of Jesus in your own life. It's just a very, it's a very personal class, because you're trying to allow Jesus to take you through this road of discipleship, just like he did his disciples, as much as possible. I'd like to do some introductions here, too, before we get started. So, let's do it this way. If you're a discipleship student here, I'd like you to introduce yourself or your family and tell us where you're from. That way, everyone else can just kind of know you and see you and know where you're coming from. We do have people from all over, and from all ages, from all backgrounds, and from all over the world that are here. So it's a very unique group, but it's been really a great group. So why don't we start with Julian, and we'll just work our way down. If you could stand up, tell us your names, where you're from.
So we're the Nuskos, Mark, Jillian, our two daughters, Nora and Lucy, and we're from Belleville in Ontario, Canada. So we actually go to the Wellspring in Belleville there.
Hi, I'm Charlene Horst from also Ontario, Canada.
I'm Cindy Lopez, and I go to the Wellspring in Penang, and that's where I live.
Oh. Hi, I'm Alejandro, you can call me Alex. I'm from Chile, and I'm just visiting for the discipleship. Nice to be here.
Hi, I am Rodrigo.
I am Catalina
Lee. And we are from Chile, Santiago, and we are hired here for the discipleship.
Yep. Hi, my name is Bernabe. He's Mateo. My wife, Carla. I'm from Chile with this guy. So it's an honor to be here with you.
I'm Miriam and my husband Hugo and our son Miguel are at Saigo. We are also from Canada here for the discipleship.
Thank you. Does anybody else think it's funny that we're we got our sides?
No,
it's okay.
Way to this go. Will actually work out great in ministry time, because I would like to set up some time for us to pray for each other, and I'd like to cut this group loose and have them pray for you. And so this will be easy. This side will just come and get this side right here. So thanks for setting it up for me. Okay, I have just I feel like a simple word. This morning, then we will take some time for prayer and then go eat some lunch. But when I first started speaking in general to a group like this, especially you know, like a message or a sermon, it was so hard for me. And it still is, but it was especially hard because I would imagine how it's going to go. Here's how I would imagine. I would imagine I'd have this phrase that I've been thinking about for weeks, or maybe the whole week. You know, I've been mulling over this concept or this sermon that I'm going to preach or a phrase, and I imagine myself like building up through and through my message, and then I imagine myself saying certain key phrases as I'm preaching, and I would imagine this amazing response from the crowd. You know, maybe like a couple of amens, or come on, I'm gonna preach, or maybe a slight gasp. And I would get up there to preach, and it was just like a stone wall. I mean, I would say my phrase, and everyone would be like, you know, you'd hear crickets, and just be okay. And it would derail me every time. It drove me crazy. And I thought it'd just be fun just to act it out, because I can. This is how I imagine it. And this is so you can get where I'm coming from. So I would say something like, we'll use this phrase. I would say something like, the Lord is my provider, all right? Now, I've been thinking about this. Let's just say if I was speaking on that concept of the Lord is my provider, that means that I was probably thinking about it all week. I've been thinking about what that means. Okay, so if the Lord is my provider, that means that really it doesn't matter where I work. It doesn't matter. My source, my provision financially doesn't actually come from my paycheck. It doesn't actually come from my boss. It comes from the Lord. Now, it looks like it comes from my paycheck, my boss, but ultimately the Lord is my source. He's my provider. He's my provider in my health. He's my provider in every part of my life. The Lord, he's my provider. And so I would say something like that, and it just seemed like it would fall flat. And I've been thinking about it all week. And so this is how, let's just act it out as if it actually happened how I imagined it. So I'm just going to call for some volunteers here. I need about three, let's do four people who can say amen. I get some raising hands of four people. Okay, right. At least four right there. Okay, we got four right here. How many was there? All right, you got four. I think you know who you are. If you raise your hand, you're an amen person.
Amen. Now,
we need like maybe two preach, like preach it. Maybe someone can say that. You got one right there? Need another one. Another preach it. One right over there. All right, now we need a couple of people who are going to be like, like, what did you say? Really consider it.
Wait, he changes his
vote.
He's gonna go.
No, you're the okay.
No, preach. Sure? Yeah, I'm preaching. I'm fine.
We need about maybe three more hmms. Down right there. All right. Steve, you're a hmm. All right.
We got quarter.
There you go. Okay, we got a couple here. What other responses was I imagining? I don't know. If everyone else, maybe just give me like a slight gasp or something. So I'm just gonna do like a quick little practice session here, and the key phrase is, the Lord is my only provider. All right?
Amen.
Hear that phrase.
Amen. Amen.
When you hear that phrase, just give me a line, all right? So sometimes I feel like I'm Paul. Sometimes I feel like I get what he's saying when he says, I've learned to be content with a lot or a little, because I feel like I have seen some of it in my own life where I feel like, when you say maybe financially, where I've been like living from paycheck to paycheck, but then I feel like I have seen more. And even in my relationships or even grace, I feel like sometimes I've run out of grace, I'm in a wilderness period, and then I feel like some days I have a lot of grace and life is going great. And I always go back to, you know, what circumstance I'm in and what my life looks like, and I can go down this rabbit hole of like, where is this coming from? Where am I receiving this? And every time I come back to it, the more I think about it, the more I realize that the Lord, He's my provider. The Lord.
Amen.
Is
my provider.
That's how I imagine it. He's my source, he's my provider, and I imagine I would say something like that, and I would get a response like that, and I would get nothing like that response when I was up here speaking. And I'm like, God, these people, I was just venting to the Lord and being like, I can't speak to these people. There's no response. It's a stone wall. Nobody is, you know, these are just not very spiritual people is how I would put it. And I get frustrated.
Amen.
And then I realized the Lord showed me something. He said, they haven't been thinking about it a week like you have. Because when I was preparing for the message, it was going through my mind, you know. It's, you know, when you're in the shower, you know, these thoughts are coming through your mind. When you're driving your truck, thoughts are in your mind. When you're going for a run, you know, this stuff, you're just working through all these concepts or this thought. If you were to stand up here and speak, you'd be amazed at how much of your mental space that takes and how actually the Lord uses that and he speaks to you through that. And so I've been thinking about it all week, but I'd come up here to speak, and none of you had, most likely, had not been thinking about that all week. You hadn't been meditating on it. You hadn't been given a thought. You've got your own life. You've been thinking about your own things. And so when I would speak up, when I come up here and speak and say that, it just fall flat. And the Lord began to show me that, like, to first of all, cut some slack to the crowd and give you some grace because the crowd hasn't been meditating on that all week. And then he began to show me that really this whole thing of meditation is extremely powerful because we're always thinking. We're always meditating. There's always thoughts that are running through our mind. And it's just different for every single one of us. But if we can actually direct that in a way and control it and harness it, the Lord can just show us so much. And he will come into our thoughts and he will rewire our brains if we allow him. And so it ultimately all came down to what am I thinking about and what's everybody else thinking about? What are we meditating on all the time? Because we are always thinking. And as I began to realize that, like, it was the Lord was taking these simple concepts, and simply the fact because I had to preach on that concept, I was forcing myself, I was putting myself in a position where I had to meditate on it. The Lord began to download things into my mind and into my life. And it's just maybe a simple concept like the Lord is my provider, but the God
Amen.
Began
Amen.
That synchrony.
They missed that.
Great.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Makes me feel good. But he began to download just simple concepts into my life through meditation, through simply thinking about it and taking time and letting him speak into that. And I began to see it actually all throughout the Bible. There's a proverb here that's really cool. Just super simple. It's in Proverbs 24, verses 30-34. It's a story here. Here's a story. He says, I went by the field of the lazy man and by the vineyard of the man devoid of understanding. And there it was, all overgrown with thorns. Its surface was covered with nettles. Its stone wall was broken down. So he's walking and he sees this broken down, overgrown stone wall. And he says, when I saw it, I considered it well. I looked on it and received instruction. I just love those three things because it's like this guy, he's walking along and it's like he's got nowhere to be. He's got nowhere to go. He's walking along. He sees a stone wall. And it says he looked at the stone wall. So he stopped. He looked at it. He considered it well. So he gave it some time, thought about it, and received instruction. But I wonder, how many times have I missed instruction by simply not taking the time to actually think, to actually stop, and actually look? I think the Lord wants to give us so much instruction, but we often don't take those first two steps where you stop, you see it, and you consider it well. I mean, how many times, when was the last time you actually were on a walk and you stopped and you stared at a stone wall for just a couple of seconds or a few minutes? You know? We just don't do that. It's like we always have somewhere else to go or somewhere else to be. But here's this guy walking along. He sees the stone wall. He stops. He looks at it. He thinks about it. And then the Lord downloads this proverb into his mind. He says, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, so shall your poverty come like a prowler, and your need like an armed man. And it just shows this beautiful concept of how powerful your thoughts can be, where if you allow time, if you allow space for God to speak into your life, he can do that. He can take everyday scenarios, like you going for a walk and looking at a stone wall, and he can speak into your life, and it's simply through letting him into your thoughts, letting him speak to you directly that way. And then I began to see even more places. We had a guy named Bob Sorge come to speak at church several times now, but I remember, I think it was the first time he spoke. He's from Kansas City. He's a writer. He's a speaker. And he can't speak. He lost his voice years ago, and so he has to hold the mic real close and kind of growl into the mic, and it's just, I mean, you're on the edge of your seat because just the way he speaks and what he speaks on, he's a powerful speaker. But he came and spoke at Wellspring, and I remember he shared this story that I had never really heard before, and I grew up reading the Bible. We always read the Bible as kids, and I felt like I had a pretty good handle on some of these even hidden Old Testament stories. But he shared this story that I don't know if I'd ever heard before. And it was the story that he wrote a book on. The book is actually called Open, I guess it's called Open from the Inside. And in this story, he had a whole message on it. It's a story of when David became king. So one of the first things that David did when he became king is he looked at this city that he called Zion, which is the old Jerusalem, and he said, I want that city. And the reason he wanted that city was almost impenetrable. It was very easy to defend because of its position. It was up on a hill, had cliffs all around it. Actually, the people that were then living in the city made fun of David. They didn't think he could take it. And they said, the blind and the maimed, the blind and the lame, can defend this city. anybody can defend this city because of how it's positioned. It's impossible to attack. It's impossible to get into. And so David, when he became king, one of the first things he wanted to do is he wanted that city. He said, that's going to be my headquarters. I want that city. And he comes up with a plan that apparently nobody else had thought of on how to get in the city. And the plan is, where are we at here? It says it two different times in 2 Samuel and 1 Chronicles. 1 Chronicles. 2 Samuel 5:8 says, now David said on that day, whoever climbs up by the way of the water shaft and defeats the Jebusites, fast forward, it says, he shall be chief and captain. And so that's what David, he lays out this challenge. And somehow he knew, I don't know how he figured it out, but he figured out that this water shaft went up into the city. And so he said, if anyone can go up through that water shaft and then get into the city from the inside and take over the city from there, maybe open the gates up so the rest of the army can come in, you shall be chief and captain. It says it also in 1 Chronicles. And Joab was the one who volunteered to do that. And then Joab became the commander-in-chief, the commander of David's entire army for years and years after that. You see the name Joab. But it all started from him being the one to volunteer to go up the water shaft. And Bob Sorge is there, back to this message again. He's speaking, and he's sharing the whole story about Joab and working his way up through the water shaft. And if you think about it, it had to, you know, it wasn't very big, but it must have been big enough for him to fit up. He had to climb up, which means maybe he had his feet on one side, his back on another, and he's like doing that scrunch move and kind of like slowly working up it. I don't know how long it was. He could have fallen. It's extremely risky. No one had done it before, and he's working his way up through there, and he ended up getting up through into the city, probably at night, probably in the dark when everyone's sleeping, and probably ended up sneaking through the city in the night and opening the doors so that the rest of the army could get in. And he shared this whole story. And I'm like, where is that story? And I went and found it. You know, this story is one verse. One verse. It's 2 Samuel 5:8. It's the verse that I read. That's it. That's all there is to the story. And Bob Sorge ended up writing a whole book on it. And he's got a whole concept of open from the inside. And he takes that and turns it into, you know, just the spiritual parts of our lives. And it all happened through him reading this one verse and thinking about it, meditating on it, and the Lord just began to download. What would that look like? What would that look like to go up through the water shaft? What would that look like to enter the city? How would that be? What would Joab be thinking? What would he be feeling? And he takes this whole verse, just this one little verse, takes this verse, turns it into a whole story. And I remember realizing that, first of all, the message was great, but the main thing I came away with was he got all of that out of one verse. How did he get that out of one verse? It's just crazy. And it comes through allowing the Lord to speak to you and simply giving him time to do it. He wants to speak to us, but we have to give time for it. We have to give time. We have to let him speak to us through our thoughts. And sometimes it just takes something like this and saying, God, speak to me. And it doesn't matter how small it is. He can speak to you if you allow him. And I, again, just began to see it all throughout the Bible. And I've realized that, like, God actually really wants to speak to me. It's just so many times I'm distracted. It's so many times I'm like that person who's just looking at my phone. And if you're trying to talk to someone and you're looking at their phone, it can be frustrating. Because you know that they're kind of listening, but they're also looking at their phone. So it's just like this split attention. And that's often my attention with God. And I'm the guy looking at my phone, and God wants to speak to me. I love this verse in John 14, verse 2. You probably heard this verse. He says, this is Jesus speaking. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. And then he says this neat little phrase. He says, if it were not so, I would have told you. And I love that because it just gives this, it's like Jesus saying, if it weren't so, I would have told you. Like, you can actually rely on Jesus telling you these things. If it weren't so, he would have told you. So he wants to tell you. He wants to communicate with you in such an open, clear way where he can say, my Father's house are many mansions. If it weren't so, I would have told you. I would have told you if there weren't mansions there. But we have to actually allow him to speak to us. And so many times he wants to speak to us, but we don't give him the time. We don't give him the attention. But if we do, he will. He will speak to us. A couple other spots here that I just want to bounce around in. Jesus himself prayed. Jesus himself spent nights just getting off by himself and praying. And if Jesus does it, then how much more do I need to do it too? We often think like Jesus as God, but Jesus was here as man, as the Son of God, but also the Son of Man. And he prayed. And there's this great little passage in Mark 1, verse 35 to 38. Where Jesus prayed, and you can see how God spoke to him and actually downloaded something into his heart and recentered his focus. It says, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed. This is Jesus. He went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. When they found him, they said, "Everyone is looking for you." So Jesus is gone all night. He comes back. He says, "Jesus, everyone's looking for you. You know, we've got tons of need." But Jesus says this interesting phrase. He says, "But he said to them, 'Let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, because for this purpose I have come forth.'" And I can just imagine, if I thought about the scenario, I can imagine Jesus, he's extremely busy, everyone's looking for him, he's got never-ending list of things to do. But yet he pulls away, he prays for, he rises a long while before daylight, and he spends hours praying. And in that time when he's praying, God's reminding him of his purpose. And when he comes out of that, he's on the other side of that prayer, he comes back, the disciples say, "Everyone's looking for you," and it's like Jesus is so laser-focused, he says, "It's time for us to move. We've got to go to another town." Even though there's so many people looking for him, he said, "We need to go. We need to go to another town." I don't think he would have actually, I don't know if he would have known it that clear, because you've got to remember, he is the Son of God, but he's also here as man. If he wouldn't have allowed God to speak to him in that time of prayer, if he wouldn't have risen those several hours before daylight and actually let God speak to him, the easy thing to do would just be take care of the needs that are in front of him. But he's so laser focused. He knows the next step. He knows what he's supposed to do. And I believe that came directly from the result of him taking the time to pray. And God said, "You've got to go to the next town." And he says, "We've got to go to the next town." And that's what they do. And it's just so interesting that he knew right then. But I believe it came from a time of prayer, of hours of prayer, that he rose before daylight and he prayed. David speaks about this whole concept of prayer and meditation and how to deal with your thoughts, I think, almost more than anybody else. He says it all through the Psalms. There's two stories that I want to share with you, both in the Old Testament. And the first one's not very long. The first story is about David. He knew how to let God speak to him. And you see it, you see all throughout the Psalms. He would start a psalm off and be like, "What am I doing? My life is a wreck." And then he would end the psalm on a high note. And you can tell that God is speaking to him as he's writing through that psalm. God is reminding David of who God is and who he is. There's this story in Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 30. David is in a spot in his life where he's not sure what side he's on. He's actually fighting for the Philistines in this time of his life. And it's just crazy because here he defeated the Philistines. He defeated Goliath. And then he goes on the run, and he's in hiding. And then he actually switches sides for a little bit, and he begins to fight for the Philistines. And he's got these guys with him. He's got these mighty men with him. And he's going to fight for the Philistines for this battle. And so him and his men leave their families. They all have families, and they live in a small community. They leave their families, and they go to fight for the Philistines. When they get there to the Philistine army, some of the Philistines, they know who David is, because David is kind of famous. He's taken the head off Goliath, and they know who he is. And so they say, "I don't trust that guy. He says he's on our side, but I don't know. He could turn on us in the middle of the battle." And the commander of the army, the Philistine army, he trusts David. He likes David, but his guys are not on board with it. His army is not on board with it at all. They don't trust David. And so he tells David and his men, he says, "My words, this is how I'm describing the story." He says, "I'm sorry, but you can't fight for us today. My men don't trust you. You have to go home." And these men are David's mighty men. I mean, they are bloodthirsty. They're ready to fight. They're ready to go. They're very, very upset that they can't fight. They have their mind set for a battle. But then when the commander of the army tells David, "You can't fight," the only thing they have left to do is to go home. So they turn around and they go home. When they get home to their community, they realize that no one's around. Someone else came while they were away, while all the guys were out of the way, as mighty men were gone. No one was defending their community. No one was defending their families. Someone came in and kidnapped all the wives and children, and they're gone. The place is ransacked. And so now they're like, "Here we went to fight for this Philistine army. They wouldn't let us fight. We came back, and now we've lost our wives and our children. They're probably dead. They're kidnapped, prisoners of war, something." And so they're at the lowest of the low. They don't know what to do. Chances of them finding them are very low. They don't know who it was, if they're just gone. And so the men actually begin to talk about stoning their leader, David. They want to kill him because they want to blame it on someone. And David's their leader. He's the one who took them to the Philistines. And so they begin to talk about stoning David. And there's this just neat little verse here in 1 Samuel 30,
Let me see if I can find it. Verse 6. It says, "Now David was greatly distressed. The people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters." And then this is this phrase right here. It says, "But David strengthened himself in the Lord." And that's all it says. I don't know what happened in those phrases, but in that phrase, "But David strengthened himself in the Lord." But something happened where David was the lowest of low. All of his guys were talking about killing him. They wanted to stone him. And then it says, "But David strengthened himself in the Lord." I imagine it like this. And I see it first here in Psalms 119:23. It says, this is David writing. He says, "Princes also sit and speak against me, but your servant," speaking about himself, "meditates on your statutes." I think what David did in that moment, and I can't prove this, this is just me thinking, but I think what he did in that moment when they were talking about stoning him is I think he got away. I think he got away by himself, and he just prayed. He simply said, "God, what am I supposed to do?" And he began to, I think that he began to think about all the times that the Lord had brought him through something similar to this. All the times that God had brought him through impossible scenarios. Because he had a lot. His life was full of impossible scenarios where he shouldn't have won, but he did. He shouldn't have come out victorious, but he did. And I think he began to meditate on that. I think he began to think about all the times that the Lord had taken him and had taken him from one thing to the other when he shouldn't have made it. When he, you know, even all the way back to when he found the lion and the bear taking the sheep. I think he just began to rewind his life and began to let the Lord speak to him, let the Lord show him, "I've done it in the past, and I'll do it again." But it all happened through, I think, the Lord just showing that through him, by him simply being off by himself. I think that began to, he began to slowly strengthen himself in the Lord through simply meditating on what the Lord had done in his life. And he comes back, I imagine there's murmuring in the camp about stoning David. And I imagine David got off by himself, disappeared for a while, I don't know where David is. And he came back, and he's a different man. And he says, continue reading the story, he asks the priests, he says, "Get the priests up here." They get the priests up there. David asks the Lord, he says, "Shall I pursue this troop? Will we overtake him?" And so there's a new confidence that has suddenly come out of seemingly nowhere. He says, "Shall I take him?" And he answered him, "Pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without fail recover all." And they end up going after the army, finding them, overtaking them, and getting everything back, getting all their wives, their children, everything back. It was fully restored. But it happened, he could have so easily gone the other way. They could have so easily stolen him. He could have so easily given up. But something happened in that phrase, "But David strengthened himself in the Lord." I don't quite know, I'm just guessing. But I think it had something to do with David's verse here. "Princes also sit and speak against me, but your servant meditates on your statute." Something was going on in David's mind where he was allowing the Lord to speak into his life, allowing the Lord to speak to him. The second story I have here is, this is a very popular story. Most of you probably know this. This is a story of Gideon. I'm just going to share the first couple of verses. Gideon is, what's he doing? He's threshing wheat in a wine press, I think. I'm going to turn to it real quick. Judges 6. Okay. Gideon is threshing wheat. This is verse 11 in Judges 6. He's threshing wheat in the winepress in order to hide it from the Midianites. So he's in hiding. He's getting his food, basically, but they're almost starving because they're constantly being robbed by the Midianites. He's threshing wheat in a wine press. He's hiding. So that's the setting right there. And then this angel of the Lord comes to him, and the angel says, it's just so funny, the first couple verses, or the first couple words the angel says to him, he says, "The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor." And it's like Gideon has this automatic response, and it's probably from what he was thinking about the whole time he was threshing wheat. He says, "Oh, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites." And so I just imagine he's there venting. He's in hiding, threshing wheat, and he's venting. He's saying, "This is stupid. This is not how it's supposed to be. We're supposed to be victorious. And here I'm hiding, just trying to get my food so that I can survive. Where is God in all of this?" And it's just like he's going down this spiral of stinking thinking where it's just getting worse and worse and worse. And he's meditating all right, but he's meditating on the wrong things. He's meditating on how awful things are. And the angel comes and just right away says, "You mighty man of valor." And it's just so interesting because God sees us so differently so many times than we see ourselves. He sees our situation so differently than we see our situation. And so Gideon vents, just gives him this whole phrase of, "Where's God? If God is around, why didn't he save us? Why are we in this spot?" And the angel completely ignores him. He says, "Go in this might of yours." It's like unfazed. Nothing that Gideon said meant anything to the angel. He says, "Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?" And I love how the angel, first of all, ignores what he has to say, and then just comes right back to, "Go in this might of yours." And I think so many times we ourselves get in that spiral of, "What am I doing here? This is not how my life is supposed to be. Where is God?" And God sees our lives so many times so different than we see it. He speaks into our lives. Sometimes it seems like what he says to us is the opposite of what we're experiencing. Gideon did not feel like a mighty man of valor. He did not have might to pursue. He didn't have this might inside of him. He didn't feel like it. And that's exactly what God saw. God said, "You mighty man of valor, go in this might of yours." And I think we all need to be reminded of sometimes how God sees us. And he wants to speak that into our own lives. He wants to speak his heart into our lives. We just have to give him a chance. We just have to allow him to. And I'd like to give some opportunity for that actually this morning, to allow God to speak life into your life. Even though you might not be feeling it, I'm not sure where anyone is here as far as in your life or spiritually, but I want to give an opportunity for God to speak to you, kind of like what the angel did to Gideon here. And in a way, let him rewire your mind. You know, if you feel like you've been in this spiral of thinking where it's like, where is God? You know, it's like I said in the beginning, we are always meditating. We are always thinking. Your mind is always going. It's just, what is it thinking about? What's running through the mind? And if you can ask God to, "God, retrain my mind. Let your thoughts come through my thoughts," you can begin to think differently. But you have to invite him. You have to allow him. You have to give him time to do that. And so I'd like to at least start this morning with a little bit of time to let God rewire our minds and let him begin to put his own truths in our minds. And so let's do this. Could I get either some background music or maybe someone on the keys, and we'll get some music going. And I'd like to take a few minutes and simply allow God to speak to you. And so what I'm going to do is we're going to, again, cut the discipleship group loose. And I'd like this group right here, all of you that came with us on discipleship, I'd like you to pair up with about two or three people, something like that. So find someone to pair up with. And then I'd like you to find someone here that you don't know, or there's a few in the back there. I see Bobby right there. If you find someone you don't know, I'd like you to ask the Lord to encourage them and simply speak to them, similar to what you see God speaking to Gideon here. I'd like you to ask, "Lord God, how would you like to encourage this person?" And for those who are receiving prayer, I don't want you to give the group a prayer list right now. I don't want you to even say anything. I just simply want you to be here and to receive what they have to say. That's all you have to do. Just let them speak God's love over you and see what happens. And take your time with it. Allow God to speak. God wants to speak to us. That's the first thing you want to start at every time we're in this position, is realizing that God wants to speak to us. We simply have to give him time. We simply have to allow him to. But if we do, he can speak to us. And he can use everyday, ordinary things like looking at a stone wall. He can speak to us simply by that, if we allow time for that. And so let's give some time for that. Can we? Mm-hmm. I'll start with a prayer, and then we'll get into this. Let me pray. Lord, God, you see my life so differently than I do sometimes. Sometimes I'm just in that spiral of, what am I doing? You know, and I'm definitely meditating, I'm definitely thinking, but it's all about the wrong things. It's about how terrible things are, or things are not the way they're supposed to be, or, you know, work next week, or what went wrong. There's always those thoughts going through my mind. But Lord, I pray that you would continue to retrain my mind, retrain my thoughts with your thoughts. That you would download your thoughts into my mind, and that you would speak to me the way that you see me. Show me your love, Lord. And God, I pray the same thing over every person here. Lord, I pray for encouragement to be happening today. God, I pray that you would speak through us. I invite you here to speak through us and to speak to us. I know you want to, so we're going to give you time to do that right now. Amen. 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 Are we ready? Right here, I'd encourage you just